tomorrow we'll be taking the remaining lectures, and we'll try as much as possible to manage the time effectively so that we'll be able to conclude the course this time around. Earlier than now, we had sent out the schedule of the lectures as well as the course description and outline, and I wouldn't waste much time going over them again. This just showing us the description of the course, and that's the outline of the various topics that we are supposed to cover under this course. The first one is Bibliology, the Bible and Inspiration, then Theology Proper, which is the Doctrine of God, then the Doctrine of Man, Anthropology, the Doctrine of Sin, Hamartiology, the Doctrine of Christ, Christology, the Doctrine of Salvation, Soteriology, the Doctrine of the Holy Spirit, Pneumatology, the Doctrine of Angels, Satan and Demons, Angelology, the Doctrine of the Church, Ecclesiology, the Doctrine of the Means of Grace, Sacramental Theology, as well as the Last Things, Eschatology. So, what we have done is to make each of these doctrines specific lectures. And like I said earlier on, the course rules had also been circulated, you know, so that we could have reading assignments even before now, so that whatever we are saying, we will probably not be hearing it for the first time, and then whatever is not clear, we'll be able to ask, relevant and pertinent questions. We are aware that a number of us have not been able to lay hold on that. We send the electronic copies through the heads of divisions to be circulated to the DMDs and then the head pastors so that everybody can have it. We sent out electronic copies of about 6 textbooks on theology, so that even apart from this, taking this course, those electronic copies of the textbooks become resource materials for you to use even along the line of ministry. And then we have assignments that we are supposed to carry out. You know, after we must have read certain chapters dedicated to those topics, there are write-ups we are supposed to make to ascertain that we have actually read those things and we have understand what we have read there. We provide some summaries that are meant to be submitted by the end of the month of June. So even though the course is between today and tomorrow, it does not end tomorrow. We are expected to keep on doing those assignments so that by the end of the month we can submit them as we have stipulated. And we have course rules. The most relevant to us here is that we are expected to attend at least 75% of the lectures before you can be credited with this course. So if you do not attend 75% of the lectures in this course, you will not be credited with the course. So that means you may need to take the course another time when it becomes available before you can graduate on this training program. So it's important, and we are going to mark attendance at each of the lectures so that we can calculate what percentage of the lectures you have actually received. I want to appreciate Daddy, who has just come into our midst. Daddy, you are welcome, sir. So we are going into the first lecture, which is mainly introductory. So we are looking at the nature of theology, the scope of theology, and the sources of theology. And this is particularly relevant to us in the Pentecostal circle, because a good number of times when we talk about theology, people look at it with some reservation, believing that it is probably meant for those who are in the Orthodox churches or in the Roman Catholic denomination. But theology is most critical, even within Pentecostal circle. Father Lord, we thank you. Our Lord and our God, Lord, once again, we appreciate you for bringing us that we might receive from you. You said in your word that your doctrine shall drop as rain. Your speech shall distill as dew. As small rain upon tender herbs and as showers upon grass. Let it please you, O God, to perform your good word as we go into this lecture. Send your word in the power of the Holy Spirit. Grant us illumination in the power of the Holy Spirit. And help us, O God, to be able to take maximum advantage of the knowledge that we gain through this teaching. Thank you, everlasting Father. We pray in Jesus' name. Now, the first thing we talk about is prolegomena. And when we talk about prolegomena, it simply means introductory remarks. You know, something, some remarks that we made to introduce a subject, a topic. And in theology, it refers to certain methodological questions. In other words, what is theology? Who can do theology? How do we do theology? What's the nature of theology? These are the issues that we have to mention in the course of introduction. And like the word itself, theology is a compound word from theos and logos. Theos referring to God and logos study or a rational expression. So, in brief, we can say that theology is the rational study or the logical expression of God. And when we talk about this, it shows the importance of this subject that we are about to study. There is no better subject to study than theology. This slide shows the dictionary definition from the Webster's Dictionary, which we can always access, you know, because of our time, we want to try and move fast. Now, in a broader sense, apart from the study of God himself, it includes the other doctrines that are revealed in the scripture. And it involves the systematic formulation of different teachings or doctrines from scripture. And if it is a truly biblical doctrine, it is always authoritative and it is binding. Any system of theology is authoritative only to the extent that it reflects the teaching of scripture. If it does not reflect the teachings of the scripture, it cannot be authoritative. For to the law and to the testimonies, if they speak not according to this word, it is because the truth is not in them. Theology concerns itself with the ultimate reality. And so nothing can be more important. And that's why even in the Pentecostal circle, it is a must for us to study. In the book of Jeremiah chapter 29 and, you know, between verses 23 and 24, God himself was telling us that if any man is going to show pride in anything at all, the only thing and the only area where he's permitted is that he has the wisdom to have the knowledge of God. Because it is wisdom to have knowledge of God. Not to have knowledge of God is itself foolishness. Because to live in this world and not know the will of Him that created it, and how He expects a man to live within it, is foolishness. That person will just continue to wander through life and this world, and may eventually lose his or her soul. So, in talking about the purpose of man in life, there is no higher purpose than for any man to know God. We can see the importance of that when you consider Apostle Paul. With the amount of knowledge of God he had and the amount of revelation he had been given already, he was still yearning to know more of God, that I may know Him. So if somebody with such a knowledge of God is still yearning to know, how much more you and I? When we talk about sound doctrine, it is healthy. It gives health. It produces a healthy life. In fact, the Lord Jesus referred to it in the Gospel according to St. John chapter 17 and verse 3. He says, "This is eternal life, to have knowledge of you, the only true God." That's eternal life. So when we now talk about doing theology, a good number of times we want to refer to some people and say they are theologians and this and that. But the honest truth is that each and every one of us is a theologian. It is only the level at which we are doing the theology that differs. So the important question is, what kind of theologian am I going to be? And what kind of theologian are you going to be? When we talk about theology, there is a wide spectrum in its practice, such that if we are to categorize theologians, we have them ranging from the tabloid theologian to the academic theologian. And in between these two extremes, we have the folk theologian, the lay theologian, the ministerial theologian, the professional theologian, as well as the academic theologian. What normally puts many people off theology is the way the academic theologians do theology. And that's why within this spectrum, there is a safe region where we expect a believer in Christ Jesus to operate. We don't want him to be a tabloid theologian or a folk theologian. Neither are we asking him to be an academic theologian. And he doesn't even necessarily have to be a professional theologian unless he desires to make a living out of doing theology. Well, by the time we have the slides, we'll see the more detailed description of these categories of theologians. You know, the tabloid theologian, you know, he bases his theology on naive hearsay. Oh, somebody said it, and he just picked it. And that's what he bases his own knowledge of God on. And that can be very, very dangerous, because that person's opinion that he had can be very, very far from the truth. Now, the folk theologian is the one that, you know, constructs his theology according to traditions or, you know, religious folklore without actually looking at it in a critical way. And such a person can be very, very dogmatic because it's a religious tradition. He follows it to the letter. Whereas sometimes it can be erroneous. Then we have the lay theologian. This person constructs his theology, you know, on things that are standardized, though he might not be very skillful at it. So he is more reflective upon theological concepts. He is likely to formulate his theology on a system of beliefs, you know, that distinguish essential and non-essential doctrine. And he is more critical of unfounded traditions. In other words, when he hears of a particular tradition, he challenges it with the knowledge of the scripture. Does that tradition agree with the teachings of the Bible? And this person is willing to some extent to use study tools. That's why you find in the church some people, when they are studying their Bibles, apart from reading the Bible, they look at, you know, some Bible dictionaries, maybe even if it is only dictionary of Bible names. Because there are times when you are reading a passage and the key to understand that passage is to understand the meaning of the name of that personality. His name is Naba, for folly dwells in him. And sometimes it may just be the name of a town or the name of a pool, that the name has a meaning that opens up the meaning of the passage that is being read. Now, the ministerial theologian, on the other hand, is a layperson that constructs his theology, you know, based on some degrees of education, which is why we are having this training. This is the kind of ministerial education that we should have so that we can do theology in a proper way. We are trained how to do it. We learn how to use the tools. We learn how to challenge traditions and issues with the light of the scripture. So, the ministerial theologian is educated in theological methodology. He is able to use study tools and resources, you know, at a more effective level. For example, there was a time I was explaining, you know, when we are talking about mission, when we say mission and we say let's go on evangelism, some people think they are doing God a favor when they travel to Ijebu to go and do crusade or to go and do whatever. And I would say, look, if only you pick the Bible Atlas and read when Apostle Paul said that I saw a certain man of Macedonia asking us to come over to help us. And immediately I perceived that this, and straight away I left. You needed to see on the Atlas the location of Apostle Paul when he was talking, the location of Macedonia, and the sea route over which he had to travel. And in those days, when there were no speed boats and things like that, how many days it would have cost and things like that, and the dangers of the high sea that he would have faced. Those were sacrifices made for the sake of the gospel. But you see, if we just read that, you know, a certain man of Macedonia, people who have an imagination, there's a stream, he is standing on one side, the Macedonia is on the other side, and he just crossed. No! That limits the understanding of such a passage, and the kind of sacrifice that understanding such a passage can motivate in a believer to go every length to spread the gospel. He is able to openly critique personal theology against competing models. He is intent on devoting more time to reflection so that theological integration can take place. He is ready to sit down with the word and take time to study. He's not lazy when it comes to studying the word. But the professional theologian is the one, you know, that constructs his theology and makes a living in doing it. That's why he's a professional at it. So, usually, you know, they are didactically proposed towards lay and pastoral theologians in order to train them. And they conduct practical research, original research in theology, and they can critically evaluate common theological trends and folk theology. Then the academic theologian is a professional theologian who constructs his theology with an overly speculative and critical spirit. That's why a good number of times they go more into apologetics and things. And sometimes when they are speaking, they appear to be speaking above the heads of so many, because they will be talking about some academic jargons. Now, for us ministers, our focus is not that. Our focus is on the theology that we will practice for the salvation of souls and for the edification of the body of Christ. And that's why we are interested in people operating or doing theology between the lay theologian and the ministerial theologian frame. So, you can see the wide range and the characteristics of the different groups of theologians. The tabloid theologian is naive, sensational, and the gates are wide open to anything. Hook, line, and sinker, they just imbibe anything. Whereas the academic theologian is very skeptical, very critical, and the gates are permanently closed. You just cannot convince him. So, we can see the acceptable range between the lay theologian and professional. Now, talking about theology, it's not the academic process itself that is important. And this is well appreciated in that statement describing what theology, good theology, is supposed to be. Faith, seeking understanding. The first thing is faith. You have faith. You have believed in the work of salvation. You have been saved, redeemed by the blood. And now you now want to properly understand what you have believed and why you have believed. So you are now seeking understanding, having had faith. That is good theology. So to study theology is to get to know God in order that we may glorify Him through our love and our obedience. If our purpose for studying theology is different from this, then we are missing it. And that's why we must pay attention to the progression that has been highlighted. The first thing is that we must get to know Him. Because we cannot love Him if we don't know Him. And we must love Him before we can desire to obey Him. So we know Him, we love Him, and then we obey Him. That's the purpose of theology. Dr. Parker summed this thing in a particular way. He said, knowing about God is crucially important for the living of our lives. We are cruel to ourselves if we try to live in this world without knowing about the God whose world it is and who runs it. It is His world. He is the one who is running the world, and we need to know about Him. So the world becomes a strange, mad, painful place, and life in it a disappointing and unpleasant business for those who do not know about their God. Disregard the study of God and you sentence yourself to stumble and blunder through life, blindfolded as it were, with no sense of direction and no understanding of what surrounds you. And such a person will waste his life and lose his soul. So that's why theology is very, very important. And when we talk about theology, we have categories of theology. The one we are dealing with in this course is systematic theology. We also have biblical theology, we have historical theology, we have philosophical theology, we have creedal or dogmatic theology, we have apologetic. But systematic theology, for which this course is based, is the section of theology that is concerned with setting forth in a systematic way, you know, as a concatenated, you know, whole. This means arranged like a chain or in a sequence, so that one step follows the other. What is known about God or concerning Him? So it's arranged in a systematic way, so that there can be progression, even as revelation itself is progressive. Now, I wouldn't waste much time on this aspect. I want to move on fast because of our time. The other slides just show what those areas of theology are, and we want to skip that so that we can move on. Now, talking about systematic theology, there are three things that relate together when we pick the Bible, the Word of God. The first thing is to open a passage and intervene into that scripture, expound on it, bring out the meaning, which is biblical hermeneutics, or the process of biblical interpretation. We interpret what that passage means. Having interpreted what the passage means, we now bring out what is the teaching in that passage. So from biblical hermeneutics, we move on to systematic theology. And having formed a systematic theology on that passage, then we now want to see how does it apply to life, the application. And that is the process of preaching it, exhorting on it, which is homiletics, the preaching. Applying the teaching of the Bible passage. And there are certain things that make this process very important. You discover that the Bible, in the writing itself, was written to an ancient audience primarily. But it is relevant to a timeless audience, because until Christ returns, we will continue to study the scripture and prosper by what it teaches. And it will continue to be the means by which people will see the light of salvation. And then, being relevant to a timeless audience, it is applied to the contemporary audience, the present generation. It is when the other generation come that they will now apply it to their own generation also. So these three areas are connected one with another. This is just showing that skill. The Bible, when it was written to the ancient audience, what does it mean? Then you interpret it historically, grammatically, contextually, and literary wise. And then you bring in the analogy of scripture. You compare scripture with scripture, because out of two or three witnesses, a matter shall be established. It can be dangerous many a times to base a doctrine on only one passage of the scripture. It has done a lot of damage in the body of Christ. Now, we extract the timeless principles from the teaching, and then we make theological statements based on the timeless truth that is taught. We now apply it for the contemporary audience. Now, the study of systematic theology, we say, is the most important task of a Christian because it possesses intrinsic value. And it is the precondition of every Christian concept and activity. That's what guides our thoughts. That's what guides our action. What the Bible teaches us to do. How it teaches us to live. The values of systematic theology. It helps us to maintain a proper balance theologically and biblically. It helps us to avoid tendencies towards emotionalism or intellectualism. You know, intellectualism is at one extreme. Emotionalism is at another extreme. Believers in Christ Jesus must be balanced and solid. It leads to accuracy and precision. It provides the best defense of the faith because you know what you believe, you know why you believe it. However, theology has its limitations because the finite is not capable of the infinite. God is infinite, and we mortal men, we are finite. We cannot completely comprehend God. That's why when we come to the doctrine of God, we talk about the incomprehensibility of God. And because we are capable of knowing Him to a certain extent, we talk about comprehensibility of God. So there's the comprehensibility, there's the incomprehensibility of God, because we are limited and He is unlimited. There are necessary mysteries, certain things that are beyond our understanding for now. And that's why the Bible says in a place, it says the things that are revealed are for us. And the secret things, they do what? They belong to God. And then, of course, there are some accidental mysteries also. There's the limitation due to inadequacy of language. You know, human language. Trying to describe the awesome God. Then sometimes it is limited because of our incomplete knowledge of Scripture. We know in part and we prophesy in part. Sometimes revelation can be silent, and sometimes there may be no spiritual discernment to pick what that passage is saying. Now, in doing theology, there are various sources from which people do theology. And we need to know this so that when we come across people who are doing theology based on certain sources, we will easily identify, and then if they need help, we can provide help. Some do their theology from reason, logical deductions. Some do their theology based on church authority, on the fact that God reveals His truth to the leaders of the church. There's a general revelation from God's character that is seen in nature and in creation. And there is special revelation, which is the Bible. And that's God's direct revelation to man. It is theology that is based on special revelation that is sound. Some general revelation can give people certain dimensions of the knowledge of God, but it does not offer saving knowledge. Saving knowledge comes only through the special revelation, which is from the Word of God, from the Scriptures. Now, there is the stage of the truth, you know, a design of the stage of truth in terms of you know, in forming theology, what takes the frontage on the stage, what takes the backstage, and things like that. You know, because of our time, I won't go into all that. You know, this is just a picture showing sources of theology, you know, tradition, you know, and culture. This is also for tradition, like a parent handing over instructions to a child. Even in the Bible, he said, "My child, listen to my instructions," and things like that. Then this is the universe or creation. You know, you see, you know, the star, you see the sun, you see the moon, and things like that. You see the flower bloom, and those work of creation, they talk to you about the one who made them. And so you pick a certain dimension of the knowledge of God, the Creator. And of course, practice, also tradition, like prayer and things like that. Then Holy Bible, talking about the special revelation, which is the direct revelation of God to man. This is reason, trying to use intuition. This also represents tradition, like church tradition and things like that. Now, that's the stage of truth. In other words, informing a man's theology of all these sources, what takes the frontage and what takes the backstage? In sound theology, the Word of God, the Scripture, must take the front stage, and every other thing line up behind, to the extent to which they agree with what the Word of God says. You know, this just showing some sections and how they construct their own theology. You know, this the Roman Catholic Church, how they, you know, do their theology, the Eastern Orthodox stage of truth, the Protestant Reformation stage of truth, the liberal stage of truth, then the charismatic stage of truth. And you can see that at the forefront is the special revelation, the Word of God, the Scripture. And it is only after that that experience comes. And then, of course, emotions, the move of the Spirit, and all those other things, they follow after the Word of God. The fundamentalist stage of truth, the postmodern stage of truth, and, you know, some of these stages of truth, they have their benefits and their deficiencies. Now, zeroing in onto our own focus, which is theology based on special revelation. Now, special revelation is the revelation given by God's supernatural intervention in history, through miraculous events, through divine speech, and visible manifestations. And this special revelation is the norm that norms, but is not normed. In other words, it is the standard with which every other thing is measured, and is not itself measured by anything else. That's the Word of God. It is the shekel of the sanctuary. And the Bible says that everything shall be measured according to the shekel of the sanctuary. It does not matter the person who is trying to teach it. It does not matter where he is coming from. If he is not saying it in line with what the Word of God says, just put it aside. So we said this is a Latin phrase of the Protestant Reformation that stresses the importance of Scripture above all other sources of theology. The Scripture, according to the Reformers, is the standard or norm against which all other sources for theology must be judged. But this standard cannot be judged by them. You don't bring reason to judge the word of God. You don't bring emotion to judge the word of God. Rather, you judge emotion or reason by the word of God. So how do these various forms interact to form theology? You know, we have that scheme that we showed earlier on with some additional materials in terms of, you know, when there is reason, you judge the reason by the word. The general revelation in terms of what nature and creation shows you, you judge it by the word. Tradition, you judge it by the word. Emotion, you judge it by the word. Experience, you judge it by the word of God. Even when somebody brings a word, you place that word against other passages of the scripture. That is comparing scripture with scripture in order to be well balanced. Praise the Lord. Now, the Bible talks about the Berean believers. And believers in Christ Jesus should emulate these Berean believers. The Bible says these Jews, that is the Berean believers, they were more open-minded than those in Thessalonica. For they eagerly received the message. They didn't reject the message. They opened because they have regard for God's word. They haven't received it. They didn't take it hook, line, and sinker. They are not gullible. But rather, they examine scriptures carefully every day to see if these things were so. And that's doing theology. So why do we do it? We need to do it because whether you like it or not, everyone is already a theologian. The important thing then is, what type of theology am I? You permit me to use that Yoruba adage. They will say, "So baje osho shaka kojo shaka, bo baje oshoko kojo oshoko." So if we are going to do theology, then let's do it well. Whatever is worth doing at all is worth doing well. Whatever is worth doing at all is worth doing well. So everybody is already a theologian. So then we should just learn to do it properly. Now we must do it in order to answer the big question of life. Why am I here? Where am I going? How do I end up there? How do I make the best of my sojourn here? How do I live in the light of eternity, where I want to spend my eternity, so that I will have the best over there? We had a brother, you know, in the healing and deliverance unit in those days. You know, sometimes I don't know whether he was trying to crack jokes, but he was bringing it from the word of God. You know, talking about the description of believers in heaven, that some will carry palm fronds, some are going to have crowns, and he will say, "In Jesus' name, I will not be a palm front believer. I will have crowns." In fact, sometimes we'll begin to say, "Look, you better walk so that you have many crowns." Because there's no scripture that says that you can only have one. Because there are things that qualify you for specific crowns. So that if you have many crowns, maybe if there will be Monday to Sunday in heaven, on Monday you use one crown and you move around on the street of gold. And on Tuesday, you dress majestically again and put on another crown. And on Wednesday, another crown. So let us labor for crowns and not just palm front bearer in heaven. You know, so how do I live so that when I get there, I can have many crowns? We need to do theology to prepare for ministry. A popular passage is 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. "Study to shield thyself approved unto God." A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. As pastors, as shepherds of God's people, we must be able to feed the flock with sound doctrine. We must be able to feed them with sound doctrine, teachings that are solid, food for the spirit man that will nourish. Then we need to do theology in order to live as a Christian should live. No man can live beyond his level of understanding. The psalmist understood this, and in Psalm 119 and verse 34, he prayed a prayer. He said, "Oh, give me understanding that I may follow to observe your commandments with the whole of my heart." No man can live above his understanding. And that's why a man, a believer, must do theology in order to improve his understanding so that he can live pleasing unto God. We need to do theology in order to be able to worship God as he deserves, in spirit and in truth. It is the revelation of God to your mind that breaks you down, that humbles you, and you go on your face to say, "Holy, holy, holy," like Isaiah did in Isaiah chapter 6. He caught a new revelation of God. The revelation of God humbled him, and he went face down. That's why we must do theology. The more of God we know, the more humble we are, and the more able we are to worship him. So how do we do it? You determine the scriptural teaching on the topic or problem. You examine or and analyze other sources. You formulate the doctrine in a contextually appropriate way, and you develop a system of doctrines, and you organize them as they relate one with another. The one who therefore wants to do theology must be a disciplined mind. The person must be disciplined in his mind. He must have a love of learning. He must have an insatiable desire for the word of God. He must have the ability to organize the material that he studies and correlate it with what he already knows, so that his mind can be renewed. He must have the discipline not to go beyond what is written. He must not go beyond the boundary of the scriptural teaching. We must be contented with thinking God's thoughts after him. Don't let's jump the gun. Don't let's go beyond where God is leading us. It is very, very dangerous. A knowledge of the original languages of the Bible is good. Exegesis is foundational to systematic theology, and knowing the biblical language is foundational to proper exegesis. So it's good as pastors, apart from having the Bible, to have, you know, the lexicons, the Hebrew lexicon, the Greek lexicon. And nowadays, this is the age of technology. There are a lot of, you know, electronic Bible resources that have these lexicons. For example, the Power Bible CD has, close to 17 concordances. It has the Greek lexicon, the Hebrew lexicon, has the dictionary of Bible names, and things like that. And these are study materials that when you are studying the Bible, you make references to in order to pick the accurate understanding of the passage. And those of us, you know, nowadays when we use smartphones, my sword, I have it here. It has both the Hebrew and the Greek lexicons. So all these things, we need them. A holy affection towards God, Fearing the Lord is directly related to an increased ability to understand His revealed truth. Because the Bible makes us to know in the book of Psalms, Psalm 25 and verse 14, that He reveals Himself to those who fear Him. He reveals Himself to those who fear Him. So the fear of God is very important for somebody who wants to do theology. And as pastors, this is particularly very critical, because we are meant to feed the sheep. God said, even right from the days of the Old Testament, He said, "And I will give them shepherds after my own heart, who will feed them with knowledge and with understanding." So that's God's expectation for shepherds, for pastors. And if pastors are going to feed the flock with knowledge and with understanding, they must themselves be loaded, because a man cannot give what he does not have. That popular passage in Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6 that we normally quote, a good number of times people use it to rebuke the church members and whatever. And it is because they only quote the first part of the verse. They don't complete it. Say, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge," and they stop there. Whereas in Yoruba saying, they say, when you point one finger at somebody, the remaining four are doing what? They are pointing at you. If you go on in that verse, he said, "But it is your fault, O you priests, for you do not lay it to heart to preserve knowledge. I will therefore reject you as my servants, and I will forget to bless your children." That's the way I think NIV puts it. "So I will reject you, and I will forget to bless your children." It is that serious. So that's why, as pastors, we cannot but seek after knowledge, pursue it, lay hold on it, and preserve it, and use it to feed the flock. Jesus Christ was asking Peter, "Do you love me more than this?" The only way you can express your love for me is feed my lamb, feed my sheep. Pastors need doctrinal knowledge to convict opposers. Apostle Paul, he warned Timothy that in the last days, wolves will appear. Was talking about false, teachers and so on. Said they will appear and they will want to deceive the flock and sway them off. So as a shepherd who must guard his flock, you must know how to convict the opposers. And we need it in order to make a good confession, like Jesus Christ did. Pilate asked him, "Are you this?" He said, "Well, you said it." Hallelujah. "So you are correct. You yourself, you know it, so, and you have already said it." I mean, so it is when we have doctrinal knowledge that we can make good confession. There is one of those recent songs, "I Know Who I Am," we must know who we are through doctrinal knowledge. And we need the Bible doctrine to stay pure. We need it to be guarded. We need to guard the doctrine. We need to prioritize it. It must be a priority of every pastor to see to the issue of doctrine. We must not be flippant. We must not be lazy with the word. In fact, when we go through the New Testament, you discover that so much of the New Testament scripture were written because of doctrinal disputes. That's to tell you how common the issue of doctrinal dispute will be. And if we ourselves are not sound, we won't be able to guard the doctrine. And we have a list there, the books of the New Testament and some of the disputes that arose leading to the writing of those books. And in the church today, there are a wide range of attitudes. There's ecumenism, where people want to place unity over revelation. Oh, we need to emphasize love and unity. Doctrine divides, so let's shy away from doctrine. No! Doctrine does not divide. Doctrine stabilizes. Sound doctrine stabilizes. Sound doctrine produces health. There's subjectivism, feeling over fact. I feel like, no. And in fact, in Pentecostal circle, it is doing a lot of damage. I just feel. No, that feeling, does it agree with what the Bible teaches? If it doesn't agree with what the Bible teaches, it is wrong. It won't bring health. It can injure. I know what the Bible says, but I prayed about it and I feel like God is directing me a different way. The ways of a man seemeth right in his own sight, but the end thereof is that of destruction. Let's run away from such. There's existentialism, placing life over revelation. You know, doctrines has little to do with everyday life. It's not that important to me. Oh, nothing can be more important than doctrine. There's attitude of complexity, placing laziness over diligence. Doctrine is too complicated for the average person to understand. Let's just do Bible study and talk. No! Bible study is real work if you want to do it. A good number of times, some people will say, when I was doing my Bible study today, I studied 3 chapters. I'm sure you only read. If you really did a real study, sometimes you are on one verse. Because so many things will come forth. Because the word of God is new every day. Even the passage that you have read before and you've had revelation from, the day you pick it up, the Holy Spirit will just open your eyes like this and you begin to see new things. May the Lord continually open our eyes that we may behold wondrous things from his law. There's the attitude of autopraxy. Doing right versus believing right. Doctrine isn't that important if people will just love one another and do right. No. How do you know what is right without the doctrine? It is the doctrine that will tell you what is right. Ignorance of the doctrine will make you believe that what is wrong is right. And when we talk about apostasy, there's a cycle as revealed from the scripture. Romans chapter 1 and verse 21. You know, what is right and proper is revelation and then obedience to the truth. When the revelation comes, you obey the truth. Obedience out of love for God and reverence. But look at that passage of the scripture. It says, because they know God. What did they now do? They compromised. They did not glorify him as God. And immediately compromise sets in. Something else will soon follow. Following compromise, liberalization follows. But they became vain in their imaginations. And before you know what is happening, their conscience will now become seared as with hot iron. And what will they now do? They will now change the truth of God into a lie. Apostasy. And that's why we must guard doctrine. Faith is only as good as the object in which it is placed. We are meant to place our faith in sound doctrine. That is when we are safe. When you look at this illustration, look at Amish Airlines. Look at the people in the truck. They have put their faith in the horse to take them to fly. But can the horse fly? It cannot fly. Now, look at the tunnel. What's going to happen to all of them there? They'll crash. So when people put their faith in false doctrine or in teachings that are not sound, they will soon be flogged. So, we must seek sound doctrine. And that is what this course is going to focus on mainly. So that's the introductory lecture and lecture one. Praise the Lord. Any question? One or two questions so that we can move into a second lecture. It is classroom. By the special grace of God, all these PowerPoint slides will be printed, they will be, I'm sure Daddy will speak to the DMDs and the HODs later on. Because we don't want these things not to reach the people it should reach. We are going to make the soft copy available to all the HODs. Let HODs send it to people's email so that people can have the copies. The copy is available already. For those of us that are here, we might even have a privilege. We will pass a sheet of paper around. Let's write our email addresses. And I will make sure I personally send it to those of us that are here, apart from sending it to other HODs so that they can forward to their pastors. Because apart from this, it is good when we look at it over and over again. There are some things we might not even remember immediately, but because we have the material, we can refer to them.
The HODs are here, and they are the one that will pass it on to the DMD. So the job is done.
Thank you, sir. I just hope they will, because even these course reading materials, a lot of pastors are claiming that they didn't receive, and we actually send them.
Thank you for the beautiful lecture. I just want to point out the challenges that I think we find in the study of theology. One aspect of this is what we can call indoctrination. To some degree, there's a kind of indoctrination in theology. And of course, when we talk of doctrines, we are teaching people doctrines. And then we introduce the aspect of reflection. The question I want you to answer for us, because at the beginning point, you said sound doctrine is a reflection of the teaching of Scripture. Sound doctrine reflects the teaching of Scripture. And we don't have a problem with that. Where we have a problem is who determines what is the correct interpretation of the teaching of Scripture. There was a time in this country, a man of God renowned, more or less told his people not to watch television because the devil's box. And I'm sure he must have a reference to the Bible one way or the other. So people are subject to wrong interpretations of the Scripture, by on which they build their own doctrines. So the difficulty sometimes, because when people are not sound, I don't know how to really explain that area. Because it's a lot of, I think it is even having a fundamental relationship about whether you know the true God or not. You have the Holy Spirit and all of that. So how can people avoid the error of wrongfully teaching something they think reflects the Scripture and it's not? Because it's a matter of interpretation. how you interpret this, how the other person interprets this. Is there a standard by which we can say, okay, if you interpret it this way, you cannot be wrong? How do we safeguard that between indoctrination and reflection?
Thank you very much. Yes, that's very, very relevant. There's a difference between doctrine and dogma. Dogma is teaching. Doctrine is teaching. But you see, when we talk about sound doctrine, it comes from what the scripture is saying. And even though scripture touches every affair of life, it is not that it stipulates specific things on every aspect. There are certain aspects where it is very emphatic. It states it clearly. There are other areas of life where the scripture does not state it clearly. Where the scripture states it clearly, there should be unity. And if there is any dissension, is part of what I'm going to treat under bibliology, the doctrine of the scriptures and its interpretation. Many a times it stems from personal pride. Somebody is probably exhibiting some pride, some ulterior motive, some interests that are not declared, some ignorance, some misunderstanding, or whatever. Otherwise, what the scripture has stated clearly is clear, and there should be no division. But when it comes to things that the Bible has not clearly stated a point, or a stand on it, usually different people interpret it based on the amount of light that they have and the dealings of God with them. And in such instances, liberty is allowed. But where there is some area, possible danger, it is best to give God the benefit of doubt and steer clear of anything that can ensnare you. Give God the benefit of doubt. That's why the Bible says in another place that sometimes it may be advisable to go to heaven with one leg than to have two legs and go into the lake of fire. So where you have to make sacrifices to comply for safety, discipline yourself rather than be loose, and then you are missing something very, very severe. And then in the case that you made mention to, you see, there is a do not give the devil a foothold. So certain times there is need for serious carefulness, especially if the people you are relating with, take for example, a young child who does not know that fire can burn. There is a way you protect that child from fire that you won't go to such an extent with an older child who already knows what fire is like. It's the same fire, but now you have two different children at different levels of maturity. In protecting them, you go to different extents to protect them. So that is probably why that was done there. And to God be the glory, later, at some other time, the same minister that is being referred to, the pressmen, they thought they were going to corner him. They went to interview him. They said, "Sir, we learned that some time ago you said this and this and this and that. And some of your people, they even sold their TV sets, some even burned them and whatever. That now you transmit whatever on satellite, if it is now the devil's boss, or whatever." And he, thank God for the wisdom of God. He smiled. And he referred them to the scripture. Apostle Paul said, "When I was a child, I spoke like a child. But when I grew up, what did I do? I put behind me the childish things," and whatever. He said, "Come, if I preach today the same way I was preaching that time, then it means that myself have not grown. So, you know, that just puts them to silence. Yes. So, you know, that's why I said sometimes also where the scripture is not very clear and pointed on issues, you know, there's liberty and people interpret based on the amount of light they have and the dealings of God with them at that particular instance. It's like daddy wants to say something. I can see. When you have a father in the house, you...
Praise God. I don't intend to take a long time, but is a theologian asking another theologian questions. I went to theologian's tango. You better be careful. Theology leads to formulation of doctrines. And in doctrines, there are no ambivalence at all. The Bible is very, very categorical. You can classify doctrines into two categories. How many categories? There are the fundamentals. But if you step out of them, you are in error. And the Bible leaves us no doubt at all. Things that are expressly stated in the scripture. Like talking about the virgin birth of Christ. Fundamental. The divinity of Christ. Fundamental. The divinity of the Holy Spirit as co-equal with the Father and the Son. Fundamental. Heaven, fundamental. Hell, fundamental. There are issues that are fundamental. There are issues that are not fundamental quite. That, you know, are influenced by tradition or culture or your locality, like that. Mood of dressing. There was a time that some people believed that except you wear a shirt and trousers, you cannot preach. And there's nothing like it in the scripture. You eat meat, you don't eat meat. Very clear. It's not, they're not fundamental. Now, let me cite one old saint. He said, in theology, in doctrine, when it comes to the essentials are the fundamental. There must be unity. When it is non-essentials, there must be liberty. Somebody prefer one day. Another says it's another day. Don't kill yourself over this. This won't take you to heaven. But if you don't believe Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can't make heaven. You were born in hell. The Bible is very clear. Very. But he now says, in everything, there must be charity. In fundamentals, unity, which is essential. In non-essentials, liberty. In everything, charity. But then, how do you come to define what is essential? Because the question goes on. This is where biblical theology is different from classical theology. I've been telling my men, we're working on the materials of Ibcoms. I don't even want to touch classical theology with a long pole. And I will come back to what Pastor is important. So we lay the foundation properly. So you know, when I was talking, sources of theology. He gave us four sources of theology. Correct? Logical deduction. Am I quoting you right? Reasoning. Church authority. General revelation. Special revelation. But in the real sense, I will do general revelation first, because we are born into it. The heavens declare the glory of God. Well, you see, it is impossible for you to study nature and not believe in God. You must be somebody who wants to deny your own existence for you to see that the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, and it's not other way any other time, and you don't believe in God. So the general is there. Now, biblical theology combines all the four. How many? Talk to me. Because in biblical theology, you look at nature, you can see God there. Just read Psalm 19. It's there. Then, number two, in reasoning, the Bible is a very, very reasonable book. The Bible does not contradict reasoning. In fact, the Bible promotes and encourages reasoning. That's why we're studying theology. God himself said, come now, let us reason together. So God encourages us to engage our thinking in going through the scripture. There is none of all of us read the scripture. You can't read the scripture without thinking. If you don't think, you cannot understand somebody like Paul. You have to think to be able to understand. Do you understand what I'm saying? It doesn't exclude. Biblical theology embraces all of this. And then, the biblical theology, I'm coming to the scripture last. Ladies and gentlemen, there are men that God raises and anoints to bring revelation to us. If you think that is correct, reason, Abba, that God raises and anoints. Like Apostle Paul, he said, the thing I teach you, I did not receive it from men. I was taught by God. God still teaches people. After all, he says, the anointing teaches you all things. Can somebody say amen? Because if you exclude, you see, we shouldn't, because of the error of some people, throw away the baby with the bathwater. The Roman Catholic Church, they make church authority their final authority, and they are wrong, because men are fallible. But the fact that men are fallible and Roman Catholics are wrong does not mean that God do not raise men, because the moment we don't have authority in the church, there will be confusion. There must be anointed men that will be able to bring God and say, this is what the scripture says. This is what the scripture says. This is what the scripture says. They are not perfect, but God speaks through them. Can I hear your amen? Even in the times of the Jews, the Bible, when one says, one man should die rather than the whole nation die. And the Bible says, God was speaking that through his mouth because he was the high priest at the time. If you have read that scripture, can I see that? So which means God speaks through human authority. But the ultimate in biblical theology is the scripture. What is the ultimate? This is where biblical theology is different from all the other classical theology. In classical theology, the approach is the Bible true? Let's prove it. Are you with me? Let's reason. Let's prove it. So they make the Bible subjective to their thinking. That's where classical theology is wrong. But in biblical theology begins with the premise, all scripture, the premise of biblical theology is all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. Everybody repeat that to me. Say, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. That is the foundation of biblical theology. Add not to his word. Take nothing from his word. And when God was going to seal the book of Revelation, he said, anyone that adds to this word, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this. Anyone that take away from it, God will take away his portion from the book of life. Have you read that before? So, in biblical theology, the foundation is that the Bible is the word of God. Everybody, please repeat after me. Say, the Bible is the word of God. We now begin to study the Bible with that mindset. The Bible is the word of God. The Bible is the word of God. But because we are not yet perfect, that's why the case of Pastor Kumuyi that you are referring to, because we are growing part time. There is none of us that see know it. That's why God hasn't thrown him away. He wasn't teaching heresy. He was teaching what he knew at that time. And as a honest man who fears God, he is correcting himself along the way. Somebody say, I hear. But a heretic won't correct himself. He's very proud. Very. When you talk of pride, Pastor Shola Jibulu, a genuine man of God that is truly called, to whom God entrusts the revelation of the scripture, is far from pride. The moment he discovers that there's a clearer light, he will correct himself. He will be the first to even come and tell you. Pride is the nature of the devil, is in the scripture. So in biblical theology, we begin with the Bible is the word of God. Not is the Bible the word of God. Classical theology begins with a question. Biblical theology begins with an affirmation. We now pray, Lord, show me, what is that Psalm 119 verse 5? Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. Most of the people that peddle classical theology are infidels. They are not born again. They are not saying. They won't say, open my eyes to behold wondrous things out of your law. When you say, open my eyes to behold wondrous things out of your law, there are two assumptions. First assumption is, this is your word. Is that correct? He said, open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. Second assumption is that I don't know. I want to know. That is the attitude of a true biblical scholar. The attitude of a true biblical scholar are two. One, this is your word. Second, I don't know. You are the best teacher. Teach me. And when we approach theology like that, we'll go very far and will be a blessing. Can somebody say amen? The Bible, you don't believe that it is the word of God, cannot save you, cannot heal you, cannot deliver you. And one of the proof that the Bible is true is the experiences in the lives of countless number of people that have encountered the word of God. Now, listen, let me ask you, if the word of God has ever changed your life in any way, raise your hand, raise it high. That is a proof that we shouldn't approach theology with, is the Bible the word of God? No, the Bible is the word of God. Open my eyes that I might behold wondrous things out of your law. I hope I've helped a little bit. Please come. That's why I want to attend this class. One, I want to learn from him. And like Baba Adeboye taught me, he said, many times you learn from what he said. A lot of time you learn from what is left unsaid. I want to hear what he said. And I want to be able to pick what is left unsaid. I hope I've been able to apply one or two things today. Thank you.
Hallelujah. That's why Yoruba say enu agba lo bi tin gbo. Thank you, Daddy. Praise the Lord. Yeah. So we want to move on to the second lecture. Put my glasses. Okay. Yes. Yes. The second lecture is the doctrine of the scriptures, bibliology, and it has to do with the Bible and inspiration, just like Daddy mentioned to us just now. Now, I've just given a kind of outline of how I want to deal with this topic. And then there is a kind of animation here, if you can observe that. You can see the Bible as the Word of God. And you can see the enemy trying to attack the Word. That's the work of the devil. The Word of God is always under attack of the enemy. But it is already ordained for the enemy not to prevail. The Word of God is forever settled and it is victorious. And we must understand that Word for what it is and what it is capable of doing, so that we can take maximum advantage of it. Now, want to look at the different forms of the Word of God, the Word as a person, the Word as a speech from God.